Hello students, in this lecture we are going to discuss tropism in detail. As you know, in lecture 3 we have discussed what are nastic movements and what are tropic movements, and I also gave you some examples of nastic movements and tropic movements. So now we are going to discuss what are the various types of tropic movements and how can we observe these movements actually taking place in the plants. So let's start. The various types of tropic movements are, the first is phototropism. As the name suggests, phototropism means response to light as a stimulus. So in case of phototropism, the stimulus is light. Then second is geotropism, and over here the stimulus is gravity. So all these changes can be observed in plants if we try to be a little more vigilant. And these days, as we are staying at home, we have a golden opportunity to actually observe these things happening around us, right? The third type of tropism is hydrotropism. The word hydro means water. So this is response to water as a stimulus. The fourth type is chemotropism. Chemo means chemicals. So over here the stimulus is chemicals. And the fifth one is thigmotropism. Thigmo means touch. So over here touch acts as a stimulus. So these are the various types of tropism in plants. Phototropism, where light is the stimulus. Geotropism, where gravity is the stimulus. Hydrotropism, where water is the stimulus. Chemotropism, where chemicals act as a stimulus. And thigmotropism, where touch is the stimulus. Now we are going to study about some activities that can help us in the identification of all these tropic movements. So first of all, we are going to talk about phototropism. Suppose we take a potted plant and we place it in a dark room with window on one wall. In one of the walls only, there's just a small little window, and we keep that plant in that room for a few days. We will observe that the plant, it bends towards the window. So actually what is happening is the light is acting as a stimulus, due to which the plant is bending towards the stimulus. So since the plant is going towards the stimulus, we can say that this is an example of positive phototropism. So I hope this is clear to everyone. Positive phototropism means when the part of plant is going towards the light. And if we observe that some part of a plant is going away from light, then we call it as negative phototropism. So I hope the concept of positive and negative is clear to everyone. Positive means when the growth is towards the stimulus, and negative is when the growth is away from the stimulus. So this is the basic difference between positive and negative tropism. Now coming to the second type, that is geotropism. Over here, gravity acts as a stimulus. What we are going to do over here is that we take a potted plant and we keep it in a tilted position like this. So the plant was growing for a few days, it was growing straight, and then we tilted it. So initially it was like this. This was what the actual position of the plant was. If you keep it like this for a few days, you'll observe that the shoot, it starts growing like this. It starts bending upwards. So this is what will happen to the plant. And the root, it starts bending downwards. It starts growing like this. So what is this plant showing? The shoot is going against gravity. So it is showing a negative geotropism. and the root is going towards gravity. So this is showing positive geotropism. So with the help of this activity, we can show both the positive as well as the negative geotropisms, right? So this is about geotropism. I hope the first and the second tropisms are clear to you. Now coming to hydrotropism. Okay, the third tropism is hydrotropism. For this, again, we have an activity. We take two troughs. This is trough A and this is trough B. We put soil in both the troughs. This is the soil that we have put in the trough. And we put two small plants or two small saplings in both the troughs. So over here we have a small sapling growing here. And we have another sapling growing over here. Like this. So in trough A, we water the soil uniformly. We are putting the water uniformly in the soil. And in trough B, we are not watering the soil uniformly, but we have placed an earthen pot, a small earthen pot with water in it like this. So after a few days, our observation will be that in trough A, the plant remains as it is, it remained straight, the root also went straight, the shoot also went straight. But in plant B, the remaining part of the soil was dry because we have not put any water in it. But the soil that was around this earthen pot, we have taken an earthen pot so that some water can seep into the soil only in this portion. Otherwise, we could have used a plastic cup also, but we have used an earthen pot which is porous so that some water can ooze out of its walls into the soil in this part. So the root in search of water, it bent like this. So what type of tropism will you say this is? Since the root is going towards water, it is getting attracted towards the stimulus. This will be an example of positive hydrotropism. So I hope this activity is clear to everyone. In your exams, many times you get a question like, with the help of an activity, explain how phototropism takes place or how hydrotropism takes place or how geotropism takes place. So all these activities that we are discussing right now, they are very, very important for your exams. So don't think that this is just an activity to help us understand. These are activities which are important for your exams as well. So please learn these activities nicely so that in case you get a question in the exam, you are able to write it down without any problem, right? So this is about hydrotropism. The next is chemotropism. In chemotropism, I believe you people must have studied how fertilization takes place in plants in your junior classes. So just a quick recap of that because we need this for the explanation. This is the pistil part of the plant that I am drawing. This is the female reproductive part of the plant. Inside the pistil, we have the ovule. And inside the ovule, there is the female gamete. The female gamete is present inside this ovule. When fertilization takes place, the pollen grain lands on this stigma. And after that, it starts germinating and a pollen tube grows down through the style. And it is through this pollen tube that the male gamete finally reaches the female gamete. Now, a problem here is that how does the male gamete know in which direction to grow the pollen tube? Isn't it? It can grow outwards also. Why not? Why does it always grow inwards? So, there's a simple answer to this question. It happens because of chemotropism. There are some particular chemicals which are secreted down in the ovary, in near the ovule, which attracts the pollen tube towards the ovule. So this is an example of positive chemotropism, how chemotropism occurs in plants. I hope you all have understood this nicely. I'll just recapitulate it once because I know it's slightly tricky over here to understand this. When fertilization takes place in a plant, this is the female reproductive part of the plant that I've drawn on the board, and stigma, style and ovary, these parts you're already familiar with. Inside the ovary, there's the female gamete and the pollen grain contains the male gamete. Now, for the fertilization to take place, the male gamete has to combine with the female gamete to form a seed. So, the pollen grain, it grows a pollen tube downwards through the style into the ovary, through which the male gamete has to travel down to the female gamete. Now, this happens because of chemotropism. Some chemicals are secreted in the ovary which attract the pollen tube towards itself, and that is how the pollen tube grows down the style. So, this is an example of positive chemotropism. Now, coming to the fifth type of tropism, that is thigmotropism, where touch is the stimulus. The best example is of tendrils. You must have seen tendrils. What are tendrils? They are small spiral little structures found not on all plants but on many plants. If you have seen a pea plant, you must be knowing that there are tendrils on a pea plant. Similarly, in a grapevine also these tendrils are present. So what do these tendrils actually do? They provide a support to the plant by clinging onto neighboring objects. Suppose there are some fences are there around, or some farmers, they put some sticks in the field so that the tendrils can cling on those sticks and the plant can grow upwards instead of spreading down in the soil. So basically these tendrils, they are a perfect example of thigmotropism. Wherever the, suppose this is a support over here and the plant is growing here, when the plant touches this support, some hormones are secreted, plant hormones are secreted, which cause this plant to coil around the support and form a tendril. So this is an example of thigmotropism, how thigmotropism helps a plant in growth, right? So this is again a positive example of thigmotropism because the growth is towards the stimulus. So I believe you people have understood what is meant by tropism and what are the various types of tropism. Now moving on to the next topic related to plants itself, that is plant hormones. There are some hormones in plants, just like we have some hormones in our body. Plants also secrete some hormones and they are known as phytohormones. This is the technical name given to plant hormones. Commonly, phytohormones means plant hormones. So, phytohormones means basically plant hormones, and these are naturally occurring chemical substances present in plants which bring about control and coordination in them. So, these are naturally occurring chemicals present in plants and they help in the control and coordination of the plants. Now, let us discuss the various plant hormones in detail. The first one is auxin. What is the function of auxin in a plant? It helps in cell enlargement. And cell differentiation. In class 9, you have read what is meant by cell differentiation. In plants, you know that once the cell loses its meristematic ability, it loses the ability to divide, it gets differentiated into a particular type of permanent tissue depending upon where it is located in the plant. So this is what auxins help in. They help in the growth of the cell first and then in the cell differentiation, when the cell acquires a permanent function in the plant. The second category is of gibberellins. You just need to note down the spellings very, very carefully. This is the second type of plant hormones, and they are quite similar to auxins in function. They also promote cell enlargement. So this function is basically the same, so I put two commas there. Plus they also help in the growth of stem. So this is the second function. But always remember that auxin is the primary hormone. gibberellins function only in the presence of auxins. If auxins will not be there, then gibberellin will not show the their presence, right? Then the third category is cytokinins. Their function is to help the cell in division. They regulate cell division or they promote cell division. So basically, cytokinins are found in those parts of the plant where rapid cell division takes place, like in fruits and in seeds, because the fruits, they grow very rapidly, and similarly the seeds also. So cytokinins, basically they help in cell division, they increase the rate of cell division, and they are present in the fruits and the seeds part of the plant. Then fourth is abscisic acid. Abscisic acid, S here. And the function of abscisic acid is exactly the opposite of cytokinins. It inhibits growth. It reduces the growth. And it also regulates the closing of stomata. These are the various functions associated with these hormones. So you can say that abscisic acid and cytokinins, they are opposite in function. Cytokinins, they increase the rate of growth because they promote cell division, whereas abscisic acid, they inhibit growth by decreasing the cell division, and also they control the closing of stomata. So whenever the leaves are shed, the fruits are, they start falling down on their own, it is basically because of the action of abscisic acid. And the fifth plant hormone over here is ethylene. And it is the only gaseous plant hormone. This is the only hormone which is gaseous in nature. And it helps in ripening of fruits. Now, this is something which is very common. We observe around us every day, but we don't know the reason behind it. When you go to the market to buy papaya, you must have seen the vegetable vendors. They wrap a newspaper around the raw papaya. And in a day or two, the papaya, it becomes yellow in color, or it ripens up, right? Why does this happen? Because fruits, they secrete this hormone ethylene around themselves in the form of a gas, and this gas helps in ripening of the fruit. So when the newspaper is wrapped around the fruit, the gas is trapped in between, and it helps in the early ripening of that fruit, because if it is left in the open, then the gas will escape into the atmosphere and its effect will be slowed down. So that is why whenever raw fruits are packed, either the fruit sellers, they keep it in straw so that the ethylene is trapped there, or they wrap some newspapers around it in order to ensure quick ripening of the fruits. So this is how the ethylene functions. So I hope these hormones are clear to everyone. Basically, these five hormones are there, which are a part of your syllabus, and you need to know their functions properly. Now, moving on to the next topic. Actually, this topic is a question which is very, very important for your exams. We have discussed about hormones and we have discussed about tropisms. Now, I'm going to take up two very important questions which you will explain based on the topics that we have already discussed right now. The question is, the first question is, why does a shoot bend towards the source of light? This is something very important for your exams. You have to explain the exact mechanism of how it happens. So how does it bend, or why does it bend? So this answer is very simple. Suppose this is a shoot. Some leaves are there. This is the topmost part of the shoot. And this is the sun. And the light rays are falling on this side of the shoot. Now what will happen? When light falls over here, this part, auxins will be secreted. And we have already studied that auxins are the growth hormones. So since the auxins will be secreted on this side, by the process of diffusion, they will move on to the shady side. The part which is receiving sunlight produces auxins, and by diffusion, they move on to the shady side and they show their effect on the shady side, causing more growth on this side and less growth on this side. As a result, what happens is a curving takes place, and because of the curving, the shoot, it bends towards the source of light. So this is basically how the shoot bends towards the source of light due to the action of the hormones, that is auxins. So I hope the first question is clear to everyone. Now moving on to the second question. The second question is, how does a tendril coil around a support? This is the second question. Again, a very important question. Now, this can be explained on the basis of thigmotropism and auxins both. So, earlier also I have explained it. Whenever the plant stem, it comes in contact with the support, again, auxins are secreted, which diffuse to the side which is not in contact with the support. So, the side which is not in contact grows more, and the side which is in contact grows less, which causes the coiling to take place, and slowly it grows and it coils around the support. So, this is how a tendril coils around a support. Since they are sensitive to touch, so this falls under the category of thigmotropism. And basically, thigmotropism and auxins together, they are responsible for the coiling of the tendrils around the support. Similarly, phototropism and auxins together help a shoot in bending towards the source of light. So, I hope this is clear to everyone. So, we have discussed how control and coordination takes place in plants with the help of growth movements as well as with the help of plant hormones. So, this is all about plants. Lecture 5 will be the concluding lecture for the chapter control and coordination, in which we are going to discuss about the role of hormones in animals. Till then, don't forget to practice and study hard.